Welcome to Base Talk with Hagen and Hayes. Today's podcast, which is number 12, is the final episode of Series 1, and the topic today is another favourite five. Hello, Susan, how are you?
I'm good, David. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you. And you've chosen five favourite bass CDs we're going to talk about today.
Excellent. Yes, I have. And what's interesting is when you suggested this idea, and you said you have something like 400 bass CDs of, you know, I thought, wow, I have like maybe two, and I have maybe 500 orchestral CDs. And I thought, what am I going to do? So I, of course, like any person would do, I think, I waited a few days before I even addressed the issue because I couldn't handle the thought that I didn't have a lot of solo bass recordings. However, when I then decided to actually open up, I still have compact discs because a lot of the things that I have, I can't find on YouTube or Spotify and Amazon Music and all that sort of stuff. So I have all my old CDs from when I was in high school and in college and things. I started sifting through my collection. Now I have nothing like you as far as an extensive collection, but I'd say I had at least 50 or 60, and I was floored. I was shocked and excited and kind of, yeah, I was kind of proud of myself because, you know, I mean, I have several box sets of all of the Beethoven symphonies, and I have Beethoven 5 itself. I think I have 12 recordings at least.
Wow.
And then I thought, I mean, because that was sort of the focus for me when I was in college. And, you know, also Sprach Zarathustra and Ein Heldenleben, I have 10 recordings of each of those, you know, so that I had a lot of. But I started pulling out the CDs from my collection. Some of them are by composer, the way I've organized them. Some of them are by performer. I realized I need to just dump them all on the dining room table and reorganize them because it's kind of strange how they're put together. I have a lot, and there were a lot that were, for me, kind of influential, I thought.
Mm. Isn't it interesting when you go back and start looking again at the collection you have?
Yep.
And you start listening again, and it's just like going back to the past. You suddenly remember where you bought it and where you were studying and what you were doing at the time.
Oh, totally. I remembered, I actually had like very vivid memories then of in high school on a Friday night, my boyfriend and I would go into Boston because we lived really close to the suburbs, and we would go to Tower Records, which was six floors of compact discs and records and tapes. And I would always go to the classical music floor. This is one of the only places that had an entire floor dedicated to classical music. And I would hunt through the double bass section. Mm. There was one. It was small, but it had sort of a revolving door of things coming through. And I started remembering, you know, high school and college trips to the recording store.
Yeah.
And it was very exciting. And what's interesting is I chose five. It was hard, but I chose five. And a lot of the names are names that I now know. But when I was a kid, when I bought the CDs, I was like, oh, who's this Klaus Stoll guy? Okay, I'm sure he's probably pretty good. And Wolfgang Gutler, is that his name? I wonder who he is. And now I'm like, oh my God, I have that recording? That's a really good recording. So it's been really fun, and I'm really glad you suggested this idea. So the first one I wanted to talk about was a CD. It's a Bottesini recording of Ovidio Badilla playing. And on the CD itself, it's the second concerto, the first concerto, the grand duo concertante, and the variations on a Rococo theme. And I thought, when I got it, I actually have to tell you this is terrible. I think this is bootlegged. And my dad found it for me somewhere, and he made a copy of it, and he did this really cute thing where he printed out what the jacket and the liner notes are like, but he actually printed them out and he put them in like a homemade CD carrier. And I remember thinking, I've never heard of this guy before, Ovidio Badilla. And I listened to the recording and I thought, wow, this guy's pretty good, huh? Now I've taught the threnody for him, and you know, I've taught people, my students, about him and about his playing and things like that. And so I didn't even realize that I had this recording, even though I listened to it a lot as a kid. Like, the name somehow didn't stick because I didn't remember who he, I didn't know who he was when I was a kid, and I didn't remember that I owned the CD. So, anyway, without further ado, so I was listening to the second concerto, which is the piece that made me want to become a bass player. And I've probably never heard a recording of this piece where I didn't hear something special in the recording, because I love Bottesini's writing so much. But I thought that a video's playing, it's really beautiful. It's sensitive and very, despite playing German bow, he captures, I think, the Italian feel. No, I'm just kidding. I just had to say something fresh about German bow. But I really, really loved, I listened to for this purpose of today's podcast. I was focusing on the first movement, and it just, I mean, it's warm, it's beautiful, it's such a lovely piece, and I really enjoyed his playing. Did you get a chance to listen to this one?
Yeah, well, I knew Ovidio. He's one of my great friends. And so I heard him live, and we spent hours and hours talking and drinking and each other's company. He was fantastic. He was the real deal, Ovidio. He was, I thought he was the next great player. And I've heard many, many great players, and he was greater than the greatest. He was a true musician. He really, his technique was impeccable. It really was fantastic. And he didn't have an ego, because he knew he was the best. It was so amazing, really. Just to think that this world-class player was my friend. It was really very surreal. Because I'm still starstruck by all these great people I know and work with. And Ovidio was, I think, was one of the greatest. He was also really funny and a big sense of humor, and everything he did was big. And I think we talked last week when I chose my five, and my favorite photograph is about 1 a.m. in the morning when we were in Odense in Denmark. There's a big bass conference, and there was me, Ovidio Badilla, and Teppo Hatahou, and we were outside a kebab shop. And one of my students with me took a photograph of the three of us standing there. I think I still got my concert clothes on, and I was all in black, and we were all having a kebab, and that's 1 a.m. in the morning. And but while we were having one kebab, the video had two, and that was a video. And but the quality of his playing was, I think, stunning. And the slow movement, I think, is one of the
Oh,
best.
it's
This one,
beautiful.
but he just exuded style when he sat behind a bass. He just, he had no technical issues at all. But he was also a quality musician. That was the difference. Because there are many bass players who are technicians, not always great musicians. But Ovidio had it all. And a nice chap as well. That was a great thing. So I loved coming back to this one. And the cadenza was so fast. And he did tell me a story. And I don't know how true it is. And it's only one side of the story. And when he was in Romania, he was always quite outspoken about the communist regime. So eventually he had to leave. He managed to get over the border. I think he left one night, and he said all he had on him were his clothes. He had nothing. He couldn't have, didn't have a base, money. He said he slept in barns, under bridges, and he'd heard about this great player, Ludwig Streicher, in Vienna. And he managed to get across Europe to Vienna. And he said to Ludwig Streicher, "Professor Streicher, I'm here to study with you." And Streicher said, "No money, no lessons." And I don't know how true that was, but I remember a video saying, "So to me, Streicher doesn't exist." But again, why should Streicher teach for no money? It's I'm only hearing one side, so you can't really judge. But the Streicher recording of the Bottesini Concerto is fantastic. I think that's my second, third or fourth record I bought. And the cadenza, after the cadenza of the first movement, Ovidio plays twice as fast as Streicher, and Streicher was great. I really loved his playing. And when I saw him in Denmark, I said it sounded like you're out Streicher'd Streicher, and there was just a little glint in his eye, and I knew what he was doing. And he said, "You didn't teach me, and I'm better than you." And it's so. I wrote a review of this, I think, for the Strad magazine, and in it I put he out Streicher'd Streicher, and they didn't understand what that meant, so they took it out.
Course.
I think you've chosen a lovely recording there.
I just, and I was so excited when I came across it, because I knew of him finally because of you and,
Mm.
your stories that we've talked about in the past few years, and also, you know, pieces that you've published and things. And I thought, wow, this is a gem of a recording that I had completely had forgotten I had, because as, you know, a young student dreaming of being an orchestral player at first, I didn't really know the names of the soloists. And so he was just, you know, that awesome recording that I had. So that's, to me, that's a really cool, very special one, because now it has more meaning to me than it did when I first got it. My next recording, this one's kind of has a little bit of a backstory. I guess all of them probably do a little bit. So when I was heading into my senior year of high school, I had surgery and I was very, very sick. And I was sort of in and out of the hospital all summer, and I was completely bedridden for the summer. And that's something that most people don't actually know about me. But my bass teacher at the time was Pascal Delash Feldman, and she was super supportive and very kind to me during this really hard time in my life. And she would come to visit me. I mean, she wasn't giving me bass lessons. I actually wasn't walking. She wasn't being paid to come see me. She would just drive up to my house and hang out and visit. And she brought me a number of CDs, things that were way outside of my little confines of what I thought of music. She brought me Ray Brown, a whole bunch of different things. But one that stuck with me, she brought me a couple of CDs of L'Orchestre de Contrebasses. And she had been at the Paris Conservatory with some of the guys in the group. So she was really proud of them and really, you know, she's like, oh, you've got to hear this. This is great. The CD that really stuck with me the most was Le Cargo. And it's, you know, 9 tracks on it that I have to tell you that picking my favorite from this CD was hard, because the CD had so many, to me, mind-blowing new things. And so I pulled the CD out a couple weeks ago and I started listening, and I actually made my husband, Kevin, sit down and listen with me because he's never heard this CD. And he was really enjoying it. And I'd be like, oh, I love this piece. All right, let's listen to this one. And then that one would end and you go to the next one. Oh, Sablier, I love this one. Oh, how, oh, these are so great. Beret, Beret, this is so cool. And every single one, I got very excited. And I looked at them, at Kevin, at the end of listening to the whole CD, and I said to him, I have to pick one. Oh, no. But I did. I chose, it's track 5. It's called Palmas. And it was written by Renaud Garcia-Fons. And what I think, it was really hard to choose just one, but the reason why I chose this one is, you know, the opening of it, you've got strumming, like as if it's guitar type of strumming on the bass and tapping on the bass and clapping and these great rhythms. And then there's this pizzicato and arco melody where, you know, one guy's playing with a bow, one guy's playing pretty much the same thing pizzicato, but it really works together beautifully. The melodies and the counter melodies are great. They use the whole range of the bass. I thought it was really interesting. One of the guys is taking a solo and he's singing what he's playing as he's playing it in a very jazz style that my students at Berkeley will do that sort of thing. But I'd never heard that done before. I didn't know that was like a, I'm thinking of the notes and so I'm singing them, but I'm also playing them on the bass. But in this piece, it feels like it's a 4-minute introduction. And at like about the 4-minute mark, the whole thing comes together. And it, we finally get this big open, this is the melody of the whole piece type of a thing. And it's just, it's really fun. And it was the first time I had encountered so many harmonics and tremolos and percussive things more than just a concerto where there's just, you know, a lyrical line and that's it. And I get very excited talking about it because I even put it on again this morning before we met up here. And I was like, yeah, you know, it really kicks in my 18-year-old Susan, excitement of wow, these are the things the bass can do. These are the things I try to teach my students pretty much, not right away, but pretty much right away, so that you don't feel like maybe someday I'll get to do that. Because when I was in college, I was telling you, I wanted to get a group together that could play some of the pieces from this recording because I knew some of them had been published. And man, some of the guys were scared. Some of the guys were going, I just don't have time to practice it because they're hard. And I was so disappointed because I really wanted to play them. Now you know this CD or this piece.
I do, and you were saying about the nine tracks, and it's like nine favorite pieces. It was amazing. I'd never heard of them, and I helped set up Double Bassist magazine many, many years ago. And I think the first couple of issues, I think I reviewed half a dozen six CDs in each magazine, and there were two CDs from L'Orchestre de Contrebasse, and I was absolutely blown away by everything. I'd never heard playing like it. It's not only different, it was also quality, and the musicianship and the ensemble were stunning, absolutely fantastic. And it's everything which we didn't do on the bass at the time, and they put them all together and it works, and just every piece I think is stunning. And I think you chose a really fantastic one with Palmas. My favorite is Weekend at Deauville.
Isn't that one great?
Isn't it? And I think I've got the music for it, and I think it's quite aleatoric, and so every performance will be different, but it's just such amazing music, and you can just hear the quality of the players. And as a composer, I'm sort of listening to the effects, and you said about one playing arco and then another playing it pizzicato, and it's such a nice effect, that one. It
Yeah, it's
really is.
really well done. And
They're my next duet.
yeah, I think so. I think we maybe for April.
I think.
I think it was kind of an interesting overlap of like jazz and classical, the best aspects of both of them. And like you said, all of these players are so talented. And I think that makes a world of difference because if you even had one weak link, it
But
wouldn't sound
you
like
know,
it
as a
does.
performer, how many hours we put into everything we do, and you can hear the hours they put into this, because it is just the ensemble is superb. It's just absolutely fantastic. And it's really, half a dozen players at the top of their game who really knew what they were doing. And it sounds like they love what they're doing.
It does, doesn't it? And I think that was part of what was inspirational to me as a kid was I felt like I could feel and hear their excitement. And it's sort
Fantastic.
of,
So shall we listen
yeah.
to part of Palmas?
Yes. Great. Okay. I love that. So the next CD, this one, I guess they all have stories, don't they? Music is more than just music to me. There's always a story that goes with it. So when I was a fellowship student at Tanglewood Music Center, the summer home of the Boston Symphony, one of the summers we did an exchange with the Gustav Mahler Jugend Orchestra in Germany. And it was that they had 12 bass players, and they were all guys. And our section had seven bass players, and I was the only person that wasn't a guy. And the Boston Symphony had nine bass players, all guys. And the high school, the Boston University Tanglewood Institute, had eight, and they were all guys. So I was sort of the lone gal amongst 40 some odd bass players. But I thought it was really interesting we got to collaborate with these students that weren't just from Germany. It's the Gustav Mahler Youth Orchestra is sort of like the European equivalent at the time of Tanglewood. And everyone's sort of the same level, the same age group, that sort of thing. And I mean, the guys that were in that section are now, a lot of them have huge jobs all over the world. And one of them was Diego Zacarias. And Diego, And I sat down and played some Bartok duets, and we played excerpts together and really learned a lot from each other. So, years later, it must have been about 2015, I was at an ISB convention out in Colorado. It was the first one I'd been to, and I went, maybe it was 2017, and I went and I played with my boss from Berkeley, Steve Bailey. But I saw a recital was being given by Diego, who, of course, I mean, there was no Facebook or anything like that, so we hadn't kept in touch. But I went to Diego's recital, and I was like, oh my gosh, I introduced myself, and he totally remembered me, and it was really great. One of the pieces on his recital was the first time I ever heard any of Simone Garcia's music, and this is The Transience of Life, and that was written in memory of František Pošta. So it's kind of meaningful to you. Now, Recital Music published this, didn't they?
I commissioned this.
Yes.
It's written for me.
Fabulous. I love it. This is so cool.
It was so interesting when you chose all these CDs. I thought, wow, I've got a story for each CD. This one, yeah, I commissioned. I think it was 2014. Frank would have been 95. So I commissioned a series of pieces. And I wrote a couple of pieces. And it was a really nice piece from Simon. Really nice. So yeah, I do publish it. And I wrote the CD notes for this CD. Diego asked me to do that. And it was so interesting. When I was looking today, he never thanked me in the CD. He thanks everybody else. And there's no mention of me.
Well, we have
Thank you,
a
Diego.
belated thank you for writing those notes.
I loved writing them, I have to say. Yeah, I think I knew all the pieces, and some of them we publish, which is quite nice. In fact, most of the pieces we put, when I look at it, most of the pieces we publish, and it's really nice. But Transience of Life was really and a really fantastic piece. I loved it, and I was so grateful to Simon. And I can't remember where I got the commission fee from. Maybe I paid for it, or I got a few people to put money together to commission him. But it's a really fantastic piece. I think it should be better known.
I
I
think it
think
should
it
be
really
too.
is, it uses the bass really well.
It really does. The first I heard Diego play it live, and I actually ran up to him afterwards. I said, "Okay, where did you get this? Who publishes it? I need this piece. I have to learn it." And he said, "Oh, Recital Music publishes it. It's David Hayes. Just, get a copy on his website." So I did, and this was before I knew you. And so this was one of many things that I ha purchased, and I learned it. I put it on a recital. I absolutely love the piece. And so when Simone's CD came out, I said, "Oh, geez, I've got to get this CD just because, he's an old friend and all that." And I was like, "Oh, The Transience of Life is on this too, which is great." This is a fun CD because there's a lot of really good music on it. But to me, this Simone Garcia piece is pivotal for me because it opened a door of learning and performing new music from living composers, and it was just really exciting. And I started from this piece, I started to learn things like who you are, who Poshta was, and all of this history that informs all the music now being written. And so it's a great recording of the piece. If it weren't, I would still love it because of the piece and what it means to me and how it's sort of changed the trajectory of my life in some respects. But so I saw this and I thought, I'd forgotten that I even had the CD.
Well, Simon, I think, is a great composer. He writes really fantastic music. And it's interesting, this one, because it's quite episodic. And often there's no link from one section to the next. It just changes from first gear to fourth gear. But it works. And that's
It
your job as
does.
a musician, is to work out how to get from first gear to fourth gear. And it doesn't sound like you're going from first gear to fourth gear. And he really does know how to use the bass well. And he's really funny because he's a really great player. But he would never say he was. And he always said, I don't care about the difficulties. It's not my problem. It's your problem. And he said, my problem is writing it. And sometimes I commissioned him. And I said, I'm really looking forward to hearing this piece. He says, so am I, because he hadn't written it.
Simone is a great person to work with, and I've gotten to perform his concerto for amplified double bass and string orchestra, well, twice last season, twice this coming season, well, with two different orchestras, technically it'll be three performances. And his music is, it's fun to play, and entertaining for the audiences, and he always has a little bit of like a Spanish flair, which of course he's Spanish, so it makes sense. But that's in America these days, that's very appreciated. People are loving, new flavors and rhythms and things like that. So I think that, that's really fun. I want people to get to hear a little bit of this piece.
Well, it's nice because we'll play some of Simon's music in April when we come
Yes.
out to Boston.
Yes.
And
That'll be
his
fun.
music, all the audiences love his music, and it's so nice. It's nice to play. And my students love playing it. They
I
enjoy
do
learning
too.
it, and they learn lots of different things because it's not just
Yeah.
about playing the notes. It's also about
Right,
playing the
right.
style and how the parts fit together. So
Yes.
I'm sure all your students will love to hear more of Simon's music.
Oh, they will, for sure. I think all the audiences will.
So
So
shall we
let's
hear a little bit
let.
of this?
Yeah, absolutely. The next CD, I couldn't not have a Gary Carr CD on here, right? He's been so pivotal for the double bass world just from the beginning of when he started playing and performing. This was another CD that my teacher in high school, Pascal Delage Feldman, had given me. She gave me a couple of Gary Carr CDs, and this one here is the Basso Cantabile CD where he does arias, opera arias. There's 16 tracks on it, and again, they're all quite lovely and they're all really fun. But the one that got me, track 10, is the Donizetti Una Furtiva Lagrima. The reason why I love this one so much, this piece really spoke to me when I was in high school, and I loved it so much that I would put the CD on and I transcribed it by hand, stupidly not realizing it had been published and that I could get access to it. I could have gotten the vocal part and gone from there. There were a million ways I could have done it, but I was so excited by it that I actually sat down, and anybody who knows me knows that I'm not a person who likes to take the time to transcribe things. I really don't. I get a little bit like, oh God, can't this be done already? But I loved it so much that I enjoyed transcribing it. And I've actually put this piece on recitals with my dad playing. I believe it was guitar. It could have been electric bass, but I'm pretty sure he was accompanying me playing guitar. And I've actually gotten to play the opera. And every time you get to that aria, I'm like, oh, I love this aria. But it was a moment where, Gary just really makes the bass sing. And you can really hear how the instrument is an extension of the human voice. And thank God, because I really shouldn't sing. My students all know I'll sing to them. I really shouldn't. But I can do it through my bass. And I just if you just feel like you're flying when you play these opera arias. I think every piece on this CD, they're all quite lovely. The Sonnambula is on this too. It's just such great stuff. But the Una Furtiva Lagrima was one that just really stuck with me, maybe because of my age at the time, and the melodramatic feeling of it was just perfect. Have you listened to this one?
I had the CD forever. I've known Gary for a long time. I heard him play when I was about 17 or 18, so it's 2 or 3 years ago now. And if only. And he very kindly sent me a whole bunch of CDs. And this I love this one because this is what Gary does. He sings. And this particular one is so soulful, the beauty of his tone, and you can hear he means every note, and you can almost hear the words he plays with such emotion. It's really quite beautiful, and the harmony accompanying, they really were the perfect duo. They really were.
They were.
I found this. Bottesini did an arrangement of this, and I didn't know about it. I was at a friend's house, and he got a copy of Bottesini's Method from, I think, the French edition. And it was in the back there. He arranged these little opera arias, and this was one of them. So I got a copy of it. And so we published this one. And I played it in London. And I was doing a concert with a singer, and she wanted to cut me to do a couple of solos, so it gave her a rest. And I played, and I got a lovely review, and it said
Nice.
it. Well, I think it was nice. I cut off part of it, and it said a dazzling display of the instrument's bel canto qualities. Ah, oh, isn't that fantastic? And
Yes.
but then he said, if somewhat genteel, and
Oh.
I'm not sure whether that's a compliment. So I used to ignore that
I
bit.
think it is. No, I think that's a good thing. I think it means you weren't too in your face with it, maybe. That's how I
Yeah.
would take it.
Well, I took it out anyway. I just put a dazzling display of these suspect bel canto qualities. So I always love this aria because it brings back that nice, lovely, nice quote. But to hear Gary play is I've always loved Gary's playing and performances.
Yeah,
And
it's
every
really
time I've
cool.
heard him live, I just come away feeling so enthused that I can do it as well. And I go and get my bass out, and just everything is possible. And this one, yeah, I think you've chosen a really magnificent performance here.
Good. Well, Gary's so enthusiastic, and it's not just palpable, but I think it's contagious in a good way. I know that's not a word we use anymore ever since the pandemic, but I feel like his excitement when you talk to him, when you hear him, you come away from that conversation or exchange invigorated and in thinking, I can do this too. Not because he wasn't great, he's great, but because he's so enthusiastic, you can't help but be touched by that. And I think it's really cool.
That's one thing I would try and teach my students about people who've gone before us, and how much an influence Gary has been, and how he's changed the bass world. And it's because of him we are where we are. He's done a lot of the hard work. He's taken a lot of the criticism, which allows us to take it further. I think he's done a magnificent job. I have only respect for Gary. I think he's absolutely amazing character. And we did an interview with him,
We
which
did.
was fantastic. And it
So
was
much fun.
even funnier the bit when he was talking before we started recording. There were many things
Yes.
we couldn't say.
He's just so much fun to chat with. I mean, you feel
Exactly.
like you could just hang out with him for days and just keep having new conversations and so much fun. And I think that personality there is really what comes through in his playing too.
So
It's
shall we
really
listen to a
nice.
little bit of this?
I think we should. Beautiful. And that brings us to my fifth CD. And this is a special CD to me too, because this was something that my parents bought me as a Christmas gift when I was in college. They were very excited to have found a collection of, double bass music. And this is another one. I looked at the cover, I'm like, Wolfgang Gütler, Wolfgang Harrer, Gary Carr, Klaus Stoll. Well, I know Gary Carr. I wonder who these other people are. Now that I'm old, I know. This is a gem of a recording, and it has Bottesini, it has the Paganini Moses Variations, it has a very lovely piece by Boismortier for bass and cello, with Jörg Baumann playing. The piece that I would always get stuck on in this CD was the Bottesini Grand Concerto in four tempos, and I mean, I would listen, I would let the whole CD run, and I would get kind of antsy halfway through the Paganini, which is the last track, because I'd want to restart the CD and hear this Bottesini again. And it was just really fun for me to hear. It's Wolfgang Gütler and Klaus Stoll playing the bass parts. And it was a piece, well, it's a piece I've still never performed. It was a piece that I didn't even know existed, which you'll see that's a recurring theme of as far as solo literature went for me for many years. If it wasn't something on an orchestral audition, I didn't always know about it. And I I would sing along with it, and I just love the piece, and the playing is just splendid. It's absolutely, 14 minutes of glorious playing of a beautiful piece, and I loved it. It's still a piece I want to perform. You've
It's
listened
funny
to
when
it.
you mentioned this one, the CD you had, I didn't have, but when I checked, I have a slightly different version of it, which has all the same pieces except the boismortier. So mine, I think, is an earlier edition. And I didn't know what Grand Concerto in Four Tempos, I'd never heard of that piece. And then when I
Hagen.
listened, right, it's the Passione Amorosa. And they've then added the slow movement of the Rossini Fantasy, originally for two basses. So all it is the Passione Amorosa plus an extra movement. It just makes it a little bit longer because Passione is only 10 minutes. This just adds another 4 minutes. So it's a nice piece to put into a concert. And it also means you've got slow, fast, which works really well. But their playing is fantastic. And listening to it today, it was interesting. I suddenly realized the difference between French bow and German bow. So you're playing Bottesini. And you, wow, it's different. It's different. And it's how you play.
I thought you weren't gonna say that.
Well, I suddenly realized that it's the German bow. Well, it depends how you play it, obviously. But I suddenly thought, wow, these are German bow players playing Bottesini. Still works, obviously, because they're fantastic players. But it just shows it's the bows are slightly different. Are they slightly different? I don't know. It
I do
depends
think
who's
that they lend
playing.
themselves to like a certain sound unless you are intentionally trying to get a different sound. And like what you're talking about, I remember with Beethoven 9 with the recits, when I played these through with Diego, who played German bow, he was, heavier and fuller and much more in the string and much more German sounding. And I remember coming away from that and saying to him, I need to play it, even though I play French bow, I need to play it sounding like you. And still, every time I play that excerpt or if I perform it with an orchestra, I think of Diego and how really German bow lends itself so well to that passage. And I try to emulate that. And he said to me at the time, oh, there's some things that French bow, it just sounds so much better on. And I have to try to make myself sound like French bow. And, I mean, it's not that one is better than the other. They each lend themselves naturally to one or another type of
And th this
sound.
recording is 35 years old, so and a lot has changed in 35 years.
It
But
sure
it's
has.
interesting. It's how you use the bow, isn't it? Ovidiu Badilla is a German bow player, but he doesn't sound like a German bow player. He's
No.
just pure style and quality first. It was interesting. I love their playing because I love Guttler and Klaus Stoll. I've always been great fans of theirs. I've got lots of recordings of theirs. But it's interesting how 35 years ago it was slightly different.
Yes, it was. It really, truly was. I think people should have a little listen to this piece now. It's great playing. I mean,
I
there's
think it still stands up, I have to say. It's really
absolutely.
fantastic. I think you've chosen five really interesting CDs there. I've really enjoyed listening to them again.
I'm so glad because when I first went digging through my collection, I thought, gosh, I don't even know if I have anything that's, worthy of talking about. I mean, but I didn't realize how many great recordings I actually had acquired, which is very exciting to me. And it sort of reinvigorated my popping a CD into my, yes, I still have a CD player because I need it in order to play my CDs. And
Well, I
just really
started buying
listening.
records when I was about 17. I think I bought my
Sure.
first bass record. I was 16 or 17. And then I think I collected up to about lockdown. And then I thought I'd got enough. And I've got about 100 LPs and then, I don't know, maybe 300 CDs. And I think I've probably now got enough. If you want to send me one free of charge, I'm more than happy to accept it. And I think I've got enough, if I'm honest. I think I've
Right.
supported the base world enough by
Oh,
buying
definitely.
CDs. So,
Yes.
but it's interesting, and it's interesting coming back to them, not having listened to them for
Yes.
a while. It's
Yep.
really interesting how you change and your perspective changes.
It's true. And as I've gotten older, the more players that I've learned about or met or come across, and suddenly they're not just names on a jacket lining, they're people that I've heard of or maybe even met. And that's kind of cool too, because that just brings it to life a bit more. But this was such a great project. I'm so glad that you suggested this because it made me re-listen to a whole bunch of recordings and really got me excited about music again. Not that I wasn't, but re-excited about things I'm already excited about. But it was very fun. I really loved this. I think it's a great way to wrap up our first season of podcasts
So do
too.
I. Is this number 12? I think it is, isn't it?
This is number 12, and
Wow. Wow.
yeah, this is such a fun project. I'm excited about season two. We have some really cool plans in the works for everybody to listen to. But we want to thank everybody for listening to season one of Bass Talk with Hagen and Hayes. Like and subscribe to our podcast. You can find us on YouTube and all of your favorite podcast providers. And I want to thank you to our new sponsor, Grace Gallery Design. They make
Yay.
beautiful, yay! They make beautiful jewelry and some hand-painted wooden items, and some of them light up very, decorative things for your home and beautiful gifts. And they offer free shipping in America, and they almost always have some sort of special sale going on. Check them out at gracegallerydesign.net, and I hope you enjoy their things as much as I do. Gosh knows I use them for almost all of my gift-giving needs.
Well, it's
And
been very nice. Series one, I've really enjoyed. So thank
this is
you
really
very much
fun.
for all your great contributions and collaborations. It's been really, I've really enjoyed every minute of it.
So much fun, and I can't wait for the next series of them because, well, we can't tell everyone what we have up our sleeves, but it's exciting and it's going to be great.
I think the first episode of series two will be fantastic
I think it will be.
with our special guest, and I'm not
Our
saying
special
who it is.
guest. Nope, but it's someone everyone already knows and loves, so I know they're going to love this. All right,
Exactly.
everybody, we can't wait to see you in the next series, and you all take care of yourselves.
Bye.
Bye.